Salem and the rest of the family, and just thank you all for coming. And being with the family today, this is a hard, hard, hard day. And I don't believe anything that I can say today will make it any easier. But it's a good day, and it's going to be a good day. Before we start, those of you who are new here, if you need to use the restroom, we have those downstairs, all the way downstairs. The women's is right at the bottom of the stairway. And then the guys go around the kitchen, and you're on the far side of the kitchen. So we have the audio going downstairs, so if you need to, you know, step out or go down with us, you should be able to still hear what's going on in the section. So before we get started, let's pray.
We need to pray. Lord, we need you at this hour, in this moment, right at this time, Lord, because there are not words that can bring comfort. We're at a loss. Hope is very fading, Lord. And yet, we know that you know more, and that there was a reason and a purpose for Kiri being taken from this earth and to be with you. And so we trust that purpose. We trust in you today. And Lord, we just comfort one another. Just, Lord, may we just embrace and cry and mourn and grieve and yet share happy memories and smiles and just all of those things that made Kiri who she was. Lord, and may we be grateful for the time that we did have with her, Lord. And I thank you for every person here, Lord, and I know that you're going to come to each one in your own special way and lift them up and comfort them. And so I give this time to you. In your name, Jesus, amen. Well, it's with heavy hearts and deep sadness that we're all coming together today to remember Kiri Anna Guthridge-Pirtle. She was definitely too young, and it was too soon for her to be taken from this earth. And as I prepared this week, just praying through, I have no words that can bring enough comfort. I have no answers for the question why. Why? But I do know in 2 Corinthians chapter 1 that the Word of God says there that we have a Heavenly Father who is the God of all comfort, who comforts us in our troubles. And He will meet you right where you're at in your grief. Maybe in your despair, your anger, your struggle, your confusion, He'll meet you. See, He understands. He gave His Son, Jesus Christ, at age 33 to die at the hand of a people or really a world that He came to save, to heal, to help. And this God of the universe understands, and He's right there with each of you. What is important today is that all the people who were important to Kiri and all the people she impacted in some way are together in one place to remember and to celebrate her life. This is not a memorial. This is not a funeral. This is a celebration of her life, her beauty, to share the ways in which we treasure and cherish her. And in a world that's just dark and messed up, she was a bright light to each of us in some way. My hope is that you all will be an encouragement to Jason and the family as you share with them the ways she impacted your life. And hopefully things maybe they don't know about, they never heard of. They didn't know that she impacted you in that way. It's a time to hide away in our hearts and to hold those treasures and those gifts that Kiri gave us in such a short period of time. And I would like to just start by reading. I came across this scripture actually in my own devotional time yesterday, and I think it's important. It says, Ecclesiastes chapter 3, "There is a time for everything and a season for every activity under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to uproot, a time to kill and a time to heal, time to tear down and a time to build, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to scatter stones and a time to gather them, a time to embrace and a time to refrain, a time to search and a time to give up and a time to keep and a time to throw away and a time to tear and a time to mend, a time to be silent and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate and a time for war and a time for peace. No matter what you believe about the things surrounding Kiri's death, I believe God decided it was Kiri's time. And no matter if it's 28 years, 50 years, 80 years, that time is short for every single one of us. But I like what it says in verse 11 here. It says, He has also set eternity in the hearts of men, yet they cannot fathom what God has done from the beginning to the end. And by our struggle today, by just that grieving in our hearts and that heaviness, we understand that eternity in the hearts of men. We don't accept death. We struggle with it. We don't deal well with that. And the truth is, there will always be an aching in our hearts. We will always look for Kiri to walk in from work one day, or call on the cell phone, or you know, come bursting in the door with some great news. We'll always have that, maybe every day for some of us. And there will always be something that reminds us of her. And it's the longing to be together again. As I talked with the family and went through the pictures for the slideshow and I meditated on God's word, I realized what a treasure this woman was, what a gem. And I know each of you hold and cherish all the ways she affected your life. We are going to have a little time a little later here where we're going to get to share with each other those ways that she impacted us and our favorite stories and memories of her. Jason, I know 3 years, just not enough. Just not enough. But what a lucky man. You were way out of your league, bro. Way out of your league. And I mean that in the best way. Bill, Lisa, no one should bury their child. But you are blessed parents. And you can stand before the Lord proud and without regret for all the time, the investments in your daughter, and look around this room knowing that she blessed every one of these people in some way. And I know 28 years was just, it just wasn't enough. It just isn't enough. But she had some of the fullest and richest years of anyone that I know. And Bill and Lisa, in your own words, she was the golden child, right? The golden child. And maybe some of her siblings can agree. Yes? Yeah. She just had the Midas touch with everything if you knew her. She did all things to perfection, putting her amazing and creative twist into everything. And you'll see some of her amazing artwork downstairs. One of them is just spectacular. It's newspaper clippings. I don't even know. I can't even come up with something like that. And so stick around and look at some of those things she created. And to be honest, I was personally a little stressed today. I was a little stressed for me, my church. Like that, we could even put this on in a way that she would do it, that she would be proud of. So just recognize there's some fear and trepidation there. You know, she was that kind of person that, you know, she lettered in track as a freshman, right? Something most people we could only dream of maybe doing. In some of the pictures I saw, I realized she was captain of the cheer team. She's not just one of the cheerleaders, she's captain. She taught herself to play piano and sing, and all I knew is I tried piano, I couldn't hack it. I had to switch to guitar, it's much easier. She loved art, super crafty. I would love what Jason was describing, how she always come up with some holiday project idea, right? From something she saw online. And then she didn't necessarily follow the directions that were there, but she always made it better than what she saw in that online or what was posted there. And of course, everything had to be perfect. And it didn't matter what the project was or what skill she needed, she would figure it out and go above and beyond. And she leaves behind one dog, she had an impeccable eye for detail, but you know, many of you know she loved animals. Let's talk about that. She had a passion for her work at the veterinary clinic, and maybe some of you are here from there. It seems like an appropriate title would be Animal Whisperer. She moved into a position on the surgery team because she just had abilities to communicate with the needy animals and calm them down. And of course, this started at a young age. Bill and Lisa were describing how they really weren't animal people, but somehow she convinced them to take in these lost and stray animals. You know, she had, and it didn't really matter. Cats, dogs, chinchillas, you know, any animal was kind of her jam. And you know, and she leaves behind, of course, her dog, Lola, and two cats, Patches and Mookie. The animals probably sense just her sweetness and gentleness, that kind heart that she had. Also, you know, I understand, like, you couldn't be fooled by the gentle, kind heart. I know that that Jason was describing how she's very competitive, and they used to crush at trivia games and stuff. She just had that ability, and she would just be all in. And we know how good she was at school, but Jason said she was really amazing, just had this kind of photographic memory. And his words, not mine, walking Wikipedia. That was his words. He said because of her gift for details and memory for information and history, he said you really couldn't enjoy any movies. Just couldn't enjoy a movie. Because she's giving commentary the whole time of some detail they missed or messed up in the movie, right? Or some historical fact that they didn't have right. And I remember Jesus was like, yeah, I'd have to check on my phone to see. And she was always right every single time, right? just an incredible person. And so there's probably really not enough words to describe, but you guys are going to have the opportunity. I want to hear more from you, because I didn't have the opportunity to get to know her. But I want to read from Psalm 116 this morning. The word says here, I love the Lord, for he heard my voice. He heard my cry for mercy, because he turned his ear to me. I will call on him as long as I live. The cords of death entangled me, and the anguish of the grave came upon me. I was overwhelmed by trouble and sorrow. Then I called on the name of the Lord. O Lord, save me. The Lord is gracious and righteous. Our God is full of compassion. The Lord protects the simple-hearted. When I was in great need, he saved me. Be at rest once more, O my soul, for the Lord has been good to you. For you, O Lord, have delivered my soul from death. My eyes from tears, my feet from stumbling, that I may walk before the Lord in the land of the living. I believe, therefore I said, I am greatly afflicted. And in my dismay, I said, all men are liars. How can I repay the Lord for all his goodness to me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of the saints. O Lord, truly, I am your servant. I am your servant, the son or daughter of your maidservant. You have freed me from my chains. Saint seems to be an appropriate word for someone like Kiri. She was blessed, and she just blessed everyone around her. There's another reason why I would call her a saint, and that you might not even be aware of. She had a relationship with Jesus Christ. She was baptized into him a few years ago. And I want to read from 2 Corinthians real quick. Chapter 4, verse 7 says this. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that his all-surpassing power is from God, not from us. See, these gifts she had, right? All of the treasure that she shared with us, that flowed from maybe something a little deeper within her. It came from God himself. And 2 Corinthians goes on to say in chapter 5, now we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, an eternal house in heaven, not built by human hands. Meanwhile, we groan, longing to be clothed with our heavenly dwelling. Because when we were clothed, we will not be found naked. For while we are in this tent, we groan and are burdened, because we do not wish to be unclothed, but to be clothed with our heavenly dwelling, so that what is mortal may be swallowed up by life. Now it is God who has made us for this very purpose and given us the Spirit as a deposit guaranteeing what is to come. Therefore, we are always confident and know that as long as we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. We live by faith and not by sight. And maybe some of you knew some of that groaning and that struggle, and just those things that, you know, Kiri was bright everywhere, but she had her own struggle. She wrestled with that. And there's always that, again, that eternal struggle that we have. For her, there was just more to life than what we just saw here. What she knew, and what we can have confidence in today, is that she is in a better place, an amazing place, where there is no pain or sadness, mourning or crying, a place for a truly golden child like her. And I would like to finish this afternoon by reading from Revelation chapter 21. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, now the dwelling of God is with men, and he will live with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. The wall in the city, the walls, they were made of jasper, and the city of pure gold, as pure as glass. The foundation of the city was decorated with every kind of precious stone. The first foundation was jasper, the second sapphire, the third chalcedony, the fourth emerald, the fifth sardonyx, the sixth carnelian, the seventh chrysolite, the eighth beryl, and the ninth topaz, the tenth chrysoprase, and the 11th jacinth, and the 12th amethyst. The 12 gates were 12 pearls, and each gate made of a single pearl. The great street of the city was pure gold, like transparent glass. I did not see a temple in the city, because the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. The city does not need the sun or the moon to shine on it, for the glory of God gives it light. The Lamb is its lamp. The nations will walk by its light, and the kings of the earth will bring their splendor into it. On no day will its gates ever be shut, for there will be no night there. The glory and honor of the nations will be brought into it. Nothing impure will ever enter it, nor will anyone who does what is shameful or deceitful, for only those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, as clear as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb down the middle of the great street of the city. On each side of the river stood the tree of life, bearing 12 crops of fruit, yielding its fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree are for the healing of the nations. No longer will there be any curse. The throne of God and of the Lamb will be in the city, and his servants will serve him. They will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads. There will be no more night. They will not need the lamp of the light of a lamp or the light of the sun, for the Lord God will give them light, and they will reign forever and ever. Kiri is there. She's dancing on those streets, the golden child, right? Dancing on the streets of gold. Living in a home more beautiful than probably her artistic mind could even conceive. She's not crying. She's not mourning. And she would say to us, yes, time is short on earth, right? Like, don't waste it. And join me in this eternal home. Meet me under one of those trees by the river. It's real. It's all true. Giving your life to the God of the universe is worth it. Take the hand of Jesus. Let him write your name in his book of life. It's at these times that we hate saying goodbye. And to be honest, in Kiri's case, it's really a see you later. It's also a thank you. Thank you for impacting my life on earth in such an amazing way. If you want to talk more about any of these things and eternal life in Christ, I would personally love to sit down with you in that. But for now, we just say goodbye, or really see you later. And we cherish every bit of the time we got to spend with Kiri, every single moment. I know rather than being sad or mourning forever, we're going to do that for a time. She would want us to be joyful. She would want us to relish in those thoughts that she is happy and she is in the arms of her loving Savior, Jesus. And so that's why I say today is a celebration. We get to celebrate. We get to celebrate the joy that we had here, but also just knowing like she is not in a worse place. She's not gone. She's, you know, she is living forever in eternity. And this life is just short, whether it's 80 years or 20. Short compared to eternity. And she would want you to share in the eternity that she's enjoying. And so I'd like to pray. And then what we're going to do is just kind of move into a time of reflection. We're going to have a slideshow that we're going to share. And Lynn, if you can get that prompted. And I want you just to take that time. And Mike's going to come up and share a couple songs. And just take some time to reflect. And then we're going to hear some words from the family. And then it's going to be your opportunity to share. And I just ask you that as we move into the time, just wait for, we got Terry, he's going to have a microphone, he's going to run around, going to start sweating, make him sweat, okay? But wait for him, because we just want to make sure that we can record those words that you share in the microphone. Does that make sense? Let me pray. So Lord, we just come, heavy hearts, not wanting to let go, but just knowing that we have to give Kiri over into your hands. She was an amazing person. Kiri just, man, she loved you. She loved us. She loved life. Lord, she's just that example of what you want for every single one of us. Lord, I pray for this husband. I pray for this family. Just, man, such great loss, Lord. And yet they have gained so much, too, through her. And Lord, may we just, man, may we just hold on to those things. Lord, help us. Help us in our grief. Lord, we don't know how to do this. There's no good way to do this. There's no right way to do this. And we need your help, Lord. Help us to have that eternal mindset. Lord, I pray for every person that maybe doesn't know you, hasn't been touched by you, that you would meet them right where they're at, in their pain and in their grief. Lord, for the rest of this time, Lord Jesus, may we not just mourn and grieve, but also celebrate in joy. And so, Lord, I give Kiri to you. I give this family to you. I give these people who have gathered here today. In your name, Jesus, amen.
You are my sunshine, my only sunshine. You make me happy when skies are gray. You'll never know, dear, how much I love you. Please don't take my sunshine away. The other night, dear, as I lay sleeping, I dreamed I held you in my arms. When I mistaken, so I hung my head and cried. You are my sunshine, my only sunshine. You make me happy when skies are gray. You'll never know, dear, Please don't take my sunshine away.
Memories surround me, the sadness has found me. I'd do anything for more time. Never before has someone meant more, and I can't get you out of my mind. There's so much that I don't understand, but I know you're dancing with the angels. So much that I don't understand, but I know.
like to invite Mike Gunn and his daughter. They have a couple songs they'd like to share.
First of all, I'm going to say that's not fair. I wasn't told to be right after the slideshow that I'd be expected to sing. So, I apologize. All right.
My son, why are you striving? You can't add one thing to what's been done for you. I did it all while I was dying. Just my peace will come to you. But when I hear the praises start, I wanna rain upon you blessings that will fill your heart. I see no stain upon you, because you are my child, and you know me. To me, you're only holy. Nothing that you've done will remain what you've done for me. My child, why are you weeping? You will not have to wait forever. That day and that hour is in my keeping. The day I'll bring you into heaven. For when I hear the praises start, I want to rain upon you blessings that will fill your heart. I see no stain upon you, because you are my child and you know me. To me, you're only holy. Nothing that you've done will remain like what you do for me. I'll take you in my arms and hold you. There's so many things that you've been hearing, but just hold tight to what I told you. For when I hear the praises start, I want to rain upon you blessings that will fill your heart. I see no stain upon you, because you are my child and you know me. To me, you're only holy, and nothing that you've done will remain only what you do for me. There's one thing that I've learned in my life. It's my Redeemer is faithful and true. My Redeemer is faithful and true. And everything He has said, He will do. And every morning His mercies are new. My is faithful and true. My heart rejoices when I read the promise. There is a place that I'm preparing for you. I know one day we'll see our Lord face to face, 'cause my Redeemer is faithful and true. My Redeemer is faithful and true. Everything He has said He will do. And every morning His mercies are new. My Redeemer is faithful and true. And in every situation, He has proved His love for me. When I lack the understanding, He gives more grace to me. My Redeemer is faithful and true. Everything He has said, He will do. And every morning, His mercies are new. My Redeemer is faithful and true. My Redeemer is faithful and true.
Now, it's an opportunity for you guys to share. We're here from the family first. I don't know if brother wants to go first, or I can read the letters from mom and dad. Maybe I'll just read, give you a chance to be ready. This is from Kiri's mom. My dear, precious Kiri Anna, I'm flooded with so many special memories of you. I remember looking at you in our quiet times late at night. Tears would well up in my eyes, and I would thank God for you. You were such a beautiful baby. As you grew, I saw more and more how truly special you were. You had this sweet, gentle spirit. I didn't need to get onto you because you were always hardest on yourself. You always strived to do everything perfectly. I remember one evening hearing a noise downstairs, and when I came to see what it was, you were up working on a homework assignment to make it perfect at 7 years old. I was always in awe of all your gifts and talents, knowing that they were from God. You certainly didn't get them from me. You were a talented athlete, cook, artist, student, singer, and you taught yourself to play piano, made quilts, crocheted, embroidered, did calligraphy, photography, made short films, and modeled, all of which you excelled at. I used to tell you how talented you were, and you would say, I'm just mediocre at a lot of things. I never understood why you couldn't see it. You also seemed to be most, you also seemed to be most nationalities as people asked if you were Spanish, Hispanic, Indian, Russian, Ukrainian, or Middle Eastern. You told me how the Russian kids at school would speak Russian at you because they thought you were Russian. You were definitely unique. I think they all wanted to claim you because you were beautiful. To me, though, you were British because you loved to speak with a British accent and always called me Mumsy. I've always been proud of you. I am most proud of the way you treated people with such thoughtfulness and your love for animals. You have left this world too soon for all of us. I am thankful for the privilege of being your mumsy. My heart is broken and will never completely heal until I see you again. The only peace I have is knowing that you are in the arms of Jesus and were greeted by your great-grandparents and your grandma Selma, who passed in December. I love you to the moon and back. From Dad. First time I saw you, you were entering into this world. I was in awe of the beauty that God had created in my youngest daughter. I never changed. Remembering bringing you home and trading for a minivan the next day so that you and your siblings could ride safely. That's really a sacrifice, you know that, right?
You traded in a fire.
I couldn't do it, Bill. I couldn't do a minivan, so good job, buddy. God showed me what was important. You always excelled at whatever you did. It was amazing that you could be good at so many things. Your accomplishments never ceased to make me proud. Attending your honor ceremonies and listening to you sing were highlights for me. I remember baptizing you in our bathtub and thinking that the angels were rejoicing. Your strong faith was an encouragement. I think you were too good for this world, and it did not deserve you. Later in life, you encouraged me to better share my interests and be more outgoing with them. You taught me how to love people, even in difficult times. You leave a hole in my life that will never be the same again. You will be missed by those you have touched. I take comfort in knowing that you are no longer in emotional pain or anxious anymore. You are in comfort now with my mother and your grandparents. You can swing under the willow tree whenever you want to. Love, Dad. Brother, I want to turn this over to you. I want to say that after the families finish sharing, if there's anyone that wants to share, you can certainly come up here and speak from the front if you're brave enough, or if you want to just stand where you're at and wait for Terry to bring the microphone to you, just go for it. So don't be shy. Just take that opportunity. So.
This is something I never thought I'd have to do, so please bear with me. My sister Tabitha and I wrote this together because it was too hard for either of us to do it alone. As it's already been said, my sister and I always called Kiri our family's golden child. We never meant this in a jealous or negative way. We simply recognized that Kiri was extremely gifted and amazing at everything she set her mind to do. She excelled as a student, an athlete, an artist, an actress, a singer, a photographer, a model, a cook, and so much more. I remember waiting in the hospital the day Kiri was born and being so eager to meet her. Growing up with Kiri and Tabitha has filled my life with so many great childhood memories, from racing our wagons down the hill to exploring a forest that we had in our backyard, watching Saturday morning cartoons together, circling the house on our bikes until it was too dark to see in front of us anymore, and playing hide and seek for hours. In fact, Kiri was so good at hide and seek that one time, she fell asleep under a blanket while curled so tight into a ball that none of us could even tell she was there. She had no idea that she gave my whole family such a scare as we frantically searched the whole house for her. Even as I grew up and graduated high school and our lives began to take part into different worlds, Kiri and I kept a special bond. One of my favorite things that she would do is she would give me these hugs that she called leech hugs, where she would jump on my back and she would hold me tightly with her arms and legs and stick to me like a leech. Kiri had a special sense of humor that was irreplaceable. She knew how to make us all laugh. And another of my favorite things about my sister was the heart that she had for God's creation and her ability to appreciate it. Kiri spoke often of the stars and the heavens and the beauty of the world around her. As has already been said, she loved animals like she loved people. And she took incredible care of her own fur babies, as well as so many other people's animals, through her work in the veterinary field. Something I'm always going to appreciate about Kiri was how she was a wonderful aunt to my daughter Kaylee, and a wonderful sister-in-law to my wife Malia. Kiri was so much more than just my baby sister. And my heart hurts that my daughter Lily will grow up not knowing her the way that I did. It's so hard not to focus on the time that I lost with Kiri and the time that my family has lost with her, and to just be grateful for the time that we had. I'm so thankful that I got to be her big brother. And I only wish I could have done it better. There will always be an empty space in my life and in the lives of my family that only Kiri filled. And so many memories with her that I will treasure for as long as God gives me in this life. I know that she is in a far better place, and I am grateful that this is not forever goodbye, only that we will miss her until we see her again. Tabitha and I spent so many hours talking together trying to put this to words, but there just aren't words that would do this justice. But this is from my sister Tabitha. I've tried writing this letter over and over again, but nothing seems right, and I think that's because I'm not ready to accept this reality. I've been anxious for the day that Kiri would renew her vows and have a full wedding ceremony, because I planned to give a speech. I never thought this was a speech I would have to make or a letter I would have to write. Kiri came into the world 6 days before my birthday, and I was upset because I thought it would mean she was older than me. As we grew up together, we shared a super weird and special bond. I might have been a big sister, but I often felt like Kiri was really my big sister, because she always gave me advice when I needed it, even when I thought I didn't want it. She was real and honest with me and told me things I didn't even know about myself. Kiri had knowledge beyond her years, and she was my compass in times that I felt lost. When I started my young adult life in beauty school, she was one of my main hair models. Boy, did God bless her with the hair for that. I styled, cut, and colored her hair so many times in so many different ways. She was the most picky, difficult, and perfectionistic client I ever had. But she made me into the hairdresser I am today. She was and will always be the boys' favorite Auntie Kiri. She was there when my boys were born and one of the first people to hold them. 5 days before Kiri went to the hospital, she spent a day with me and my kids at the pool. She baked cookies for us and played Marco Polo with the boys in the pool for hours. And I felt so lucky that my boys had an aunt who gave them the attention that they always craved. The last few days I spent with her, I was able to hold her hand, kiss her, look at the tattoos we got together, brush and do her hair one last time, and say goodbye, which I don't even know how to do. Life without her will never be the same. She was my soundboard on so many life decisions. She was my fashion advisor, my best friend, the only person I could truly be myself around. And when I was unsure about myself, she reassured me and was always supportive. I will miss the way that she knew me more than anyone else, and the weird noises we would make at each other when we said our parting goodbyes. I don't know how to resume living without you, Kiri. You were truly a gift from heaven, and I will always miss you. You didn't get to live out the rest of your life, so I will do my best to live the rest of my life through your eyes, seeing beauty in the small things and being forever inspired by your existence.
Is there anyone else that would be brave enough to stand up and wait for Terry in the back here? Jason, if you want to come up, or yeah, whatever you want to do. Great. Come on up, buddy.
First of all, I just want to say thank you for everything the church has done here. They have really gone above and beyond putting this together. Thank you. For those I have not had a pleasure in meeting, my name is Jason. And my beautiful wife is Kiriana Guthridge-Pirtle. Nobody sees a flower, really. It is so small, it takes time. We haven't time. And to see time, like to have a friend, takes time. That is a Georgia Keefe quote. My dear Kiriana, was the fragrance of my life. She was my best friend, lover, my inspirer, my confidant, and someone I could depend on. I first laid eyes on Kiri back in 2018 at a bar, where I was told that's the last place you would want to meet your love of your life. And she was bartending that night. And the very moment I saw her, there was no words. I didn't really understand what I was feeling, but she was absolutely stunning. And it wasn't just her looks, it was her grace, the way she treated the patrons there, and just how she carried herself with a smile, and it just seemed genuine. I know in the service industry it's natural for people to just have that, but Kiri was different, and that's who she was. And I tried to talk to her, but she was so busy, I knew I couldn't. So I was gonna ask for her number, but I guess you would call it, I got cold feet and ended up walking out the front door, hanging my head down, feeling defeated. But as I stood out on the sidewalk in front, Kiri came out of a side door of the building she was working in, and I remember just this overwhelming, like, this is it, this is your moment. You cannot screw this up. So she walked to a vacant bench, sat down, and I remember saying, don't do that, don't do it. But I did. I walked over like a creep and sat right next to her. And she didn't acknowledge me. So I'm just sitting there thinking, what can I say? Well, she at the time was smoked a little bit. She pulled out a smoke, and I said, oh, you smoke? And immediately I regretted that. She looked at me and said, yes. And yeah, rightfully so, that was a really dumb question. And I just was talking to her, and I asked for a number. She gave me her number and then said, hey, I would love to take you out on a date. At the time, Kiri was in a relationship, so she told me I have a boyfriend. So I figured she gave me a wrong phone number. But the next day, regardless, I decided that I would text her, so I did. And no response. And for 2 months, I heard nothing from Kiri. But on New Year's Eve, she reached out to me, and she said, "What are you doing?" I said, "Hello." And I, she laughed, LOL. Was like, "Hey, I was just wondering, do you have any plans for New Year's?" I did, but I didn't tell her that. And I responded, "No." And I went out and we met up and celebrated New Year's. I gave her a New Year's kiss, and that was that. And we continued to have amazing dates and really got to grow and learn who she was and fell in love with her more and more every day. Of course, it didn't take long. It got to a point where just one day on the couch, after she made a delicious dinner from scratch, I told her, "I really want to marry you." And she looked at me and said, "Well, then do it." And overwhelmed, I said, "Kiri, would you like to marry me?" And she cried and said yes. And that was it. I mean, literally, that was how we were, and very laid back. I regretted having it being such a informal way of proposing, but she loved it. And we had our wedding on July 20th, 2020. It was important that we had it be 2020. And I don't know why, because she hated even numbers. So the volume was always on odd numbers, and it was demanded to be left on an odd number. It was just the perfect wedding. I mean, it was a courthouse wedding, even under the circumstances of the lockdown during COVID. It was just a beautiful, beautiful memory to have. And not long after, really only just a few months later, she actually lost her rings. And she was devastated. And I remember trying to console her through that moment. We were actually going to Burns to be with family. And it was very difficult for her. But she never showed it to anyone. But I waited until our first anniversary to give her the same exact rings that I happened to get the day before our anniversary. It's perfect timing, because I was waiting a long time for these to be remade. And they were exactly the same ones. And I took her to Oregon City, and I took her on our first anniversary. To the place where I met her, to the bench. And I got down on one knee and I proposed to her. Because I really wanted to do it proper. And she cried. And it just was really important to me to have that special moment with her. Everyone is clapping on the streets and cheering, and we look at each other and we're like, do we tell them that we've been together and married for a year? So it was just a special moment. And we went out and we had a beautiful dinner and went to karaoke. Kiri really pushed me out of my comfort zone. She was adamant about making me live life. It's easy to get reserved and not want to really fully express who you really are. And Kiri squashed that and made me karaoke, made me dance, made me do all sorts of things that, trust me, I would want nothing to do with. But she loved it. And you know what? I loved it too. It made me really just love her even more to have these memories with her. She loved to cook. She was an incredible cook. She had a real passion for it. She cooked everything from scratch. She made a Mediterranean dish. She made the pita bread from scratch. She made the tzatziki sauce from scratch. She would make the rice perfect. Like, it was crazy. And there were these turkey-like meatballs that were perfectly cooked and breaded, and all of it, which is, she created that. And that's just an example. But she also cooked for the fur babies. And I sometimes wondered if she loved the fur babies more than me. But watching her with them and being there for them really made my heart melt. And I loved it. And I didn't care if I was, you know, in the back seat, you know, to be able to observe that and see how loving and caring she is. It was an honor. We loved going to the beach. We loved sitting under the stars. We loved just being weird. And I loved it because I'm a weird guy. And she might have had me beat, but I loved it. Kiri, it was said before, she was a walking Wikipedia. She was so intelligent. She was literally right every time. I don't know, like, I'm in serious debt with her. She is just so smart. She just knew everything. Useless information, but it was great during trivia nights. Again, karaoke'd all the time at home. We karaoke'd and danced. We'll always cherish those memories. You know, all this that I was able to share with her is something that I'm really going to miss. She just, you know, along the way, she always was a loving and devoted wife. And she always had time to think about me with my work, with my life. No matter what was going on in her life, in whatever struggle she may have had in her life, she made time for me as well as others. I think her legacy in this life is just her way of being able to communicate and be there and listen and, you know, just having you have a different perspective on things. She kept me calm and reserved when before I would get worked up about the littlest things, and she was great at pulling me back and making me realize what was truly important. And I think she has helped a lot of people in her life in carrying themselves that way, and I will forever be grateful for that. I just wish we had more time, you know. We had a lot of plans. A lot of plans. And, you know, I'm gonna carry some of those plans out, even without her, because they were important to us. And, yeah, it's just, we had a whole life together. And, you know, we talked about being old together and all that, you know, and it hurts. It hurts, obviously, that you know, we won't be able to do that. But I know she's here with all of us, and I miss her so much. And I will forever be stitched to her heart. And I'm just blessed to have somebody in my life that was incredibly beautiful inside and out. I would like to thank all of the dear ones, the group of devoted friends that gave us strength and laughter during these most difficult days. Kiriana's spirit was a part of you and will always be so. Before we continue this beautiful tribute on this beautiful day, I'd like to share a poem with you. I give you this one thought to keep. I give you this one thought to keep. I am with you still. I do not sleep. I am 1,000 winds that blow. I am the diamond glints on snow. I am the sunlight on ripened grain. I am the gentle autumn rain. When you awaken in the morning hush, I am the swift uplifting rush of quiet birds in circled flight. I am the soft stars that shine at night. So not think of me as gone. I am with you still in each new dawn.
I am in an awe, Jason, and I think I need to connect you with Hallmark or something, like, bro, like, yeah. Anybody else? Just stand up where you're at. Terry will put a microphone in your face.
That was beautiful, Jason. My name's Lonnie, and Kiri was a very beautiful girl with a sweet spirit. She graduated with my youngest daughter, Josie, and then her brother married my oldest daughter, Malia, and Lisa's my dear friend, so just a lovely, lovely family. And I would just ask each and every one of you, you know, if it's on your heart and you have the time, and if you didn't get to do it before service, maybe at the reception, there's pieces of paper that you can write down a memory, whether it's what you remember about Kiri or something funny or beautiful, whether it's something that spoke to you today about how beautiful the service was or this family. It helps the family to heal over time. It's not something that will just be looked upon today. It will go on for years, and it will help the little ones, the nieces and the nephews, to remember their auntie. Sorry. It will help keep her spirit alive. And we can put that in a nice album for the family to reflect on anytime they want to. Thank you. Is it on? Hello? Okay. Hi, I'm Candace. I am one of Kiri's friends from middle school. we rode the bus home together all the time, and she was, I wanted to write on Facebook about how weird she really was, but I didn't want to be rude, because I'm like, that was just her personality. And she came up with names for us, and she was Eric, and I was Ekanak, and it's our names backwards, which, who comes up with that? And she just shared a photo of us on Facebook, and it was us at graduation together, and I just thought that was so special that one of her last posts was her and I, like, at the end of our journey for the school together. So, yeah, I just wanted to share that.
So my mother-in-law just tapped me and asked me to share something. So, as my mom said, I married Kiri's brother, Luke. He's great. but something special about us getting married is I actually went to school with both Kiri and Tabitha. I was friends with Tabitha, didn't get to know Kiri as well as Tabby, but I did have concert choir with Kiri. So Lisa wanted me to share a funny memory that I had of Kiri, going off of what Candace said about how she's just weird and funny. So we were in concert choir one day, and class had not started yet. If any of you have been in choir or have seen the choir robes, you know that they have these ginormous sleeves that go from about here to here. And before class started, Kiri just, I guess, wanted to prank some people. And she actually, sorry, one second, can you hold her, honey? Kiri went up to one of her guy friends and said, hey, come here for a minute. And she goes, look into my sleeve. And he was just like, huh? Starts looking into her sleeve, and she's just like, look into my sleeve. And then she swallows him with the sleeve. And it was the funniest thing. And so I just sat there waiting for class, and she just waited for more unsuspecting victims. So more people would walk in who had not been in the room when she did this the first time and just kept doing it and would just go, hey, come here, look into my sleeve. And we all just watched for Kiri to get the next person. And then she would just swallow them again with the sleeve. So anyway, Kiri just had a really great and funny personality, and it was really special getting to marry into this family, having a history with Kiri and Tabitha, and having some kind of special memory that the family didn't know about. So that's my little piece there.
Jason, it sounds like you should have known how creepy she already was. You would have gone in that with way more confidence, way more confidence. Anybody else? Maybe one or two more, and then we can finish up with the reception downstairs. Right over here, Terry.
Several years ago, my daughter, Lisa, Curie's mom, started making a quilt for me. And I don't know how many years she had worked on that quilt, but never really got it completed. Well, one year, Kiri said, let's finish that. And Kiri, I think, finished it. And I got it then for Christmas that year. So she really helped her mom complete that project.
Hi, I'm Katie. I worked with Kiri, oh gosh, 8 or 9 years ago, and we haven't hung out since, but we have talked off and on since then, and every time we pick up a conversation, it's like it never even stopped. She was one of the most thoughtful people I ever knew. One of the most beautiful people inside and out. We worked together for about a year, and we talked about getting an apartment together. Like, we spent an entire weekend looking at apartments in Newburgh. And for one reason or another, it didn't work out, but she just always inspired me to just go for it. And so she was just incredibly special, and I don't think she ever knew how much she inspired me to just absolutely dive in and go for it. I have carried her those entire 9 years, and she is just an absolutely incredible person.
Over here, Terry.
Hi, my name on? Yeah. My name is Kaylee, and I've known the Guthridges for many years. And when I found out that Kiri had passed, my heart was absolutely broken for this family. I was reflecting, and I was just reflecting on, like, the impact that she had, even over her social media, because I've kept watch of her over the years, and prayed through her struggles and rejoiced when she met you. You don't even know me, but I was rejoicing when she met you and she married you. And so I was impressed to write a song. So I'm just going to sing that song. It happened unexpectedly. Your heart left us so suddenly. We tried to keep you on the earth, but you were already rising to the one who knew you from birth. Oh, Jesus, thank you for this precious girl. Jesus, she left an imprint on so many people in this world. Please bind up all the broken hearts. So many lives have been torn apart. Bind them up in your love and peace, and bless them with her beautiful memories. Oh, Jesus, thank you for this precious girl. Jesus, she made an impact on this world, for she's with you beyond what we can see. For she's with you in the Holy of Holies.
At least one more. I feel like there should be one more. Thank you. Right over here behind you. Oh, two more. All right.
One. Hi. Oh, one more after me. Is that on? Hi, everybody. I'm Amber. I was Kiri's cheer coach in high school. I've known the Guthridge family for a very long time. Lisa actually coached with me for a few years. Sorry. I had the pleasure of coaching Tabby as well. Kiri was the little sister. And Tabby was on my team before her, so it was funny. I always got really excited when I got a coach sisters, because there was commitment from the family, and like I said, Lisa coached with me. So when Kiri came through, it was great. I loved Kiri. She was a bossy. She knew it all. She was, she got you to do things that you didn't really want to. She was a captain. One of my favorite Kiri stories, if you go to her YouTube channel, I actually shared this video on my Facebook page after I heard she passed, because it was such a funny memory. But it was kind of before TikTok trends were really a thing, and Kiri and Aaron and a couple of the others, they wanted to create this video. It was called the Harlem Shake. If you go to Kiri's YouTube channel, you can watch it for some funny pleasure. But Kiri was like, no, we're going to make this video. It's going to go viral. And everyone had funky costumes on, and she's like, no, coach, we're going to do this. We're going to do a couple takes. It wasn't right until it was right. Per Kiri's request. So we make this video, and the captain's, it was just so funny because they just in true Kiri spirit, it had to be perfect, it had to be funny, and it had to be weird. And that was Kiri, and that's what I remember of her, and I'm so glad we have that video, so look it up on her YouTube channel, because she convinced me that we had to do it and guilted me into it, and it turned out to be one of my favorite memories with her, so.
Terry, there was one back over here. Right behind. Oh, keep coming. No.
Well, Bill and Lisa, I don't know what they were thinking, but they let me drive their kids around for youth group. And I don't know if Tabitha knows this, or I don't even know if Kiri knows this, but I would put them in special spots in my car. So Tabitha got to ride up front, but Kiri gets to sit behind me. My daughter Madeline sat over here. We put the boys all the way in the back because we like to sing songs going to the youth group meetings. And it was so cool because I had these voices singing around me. And they just thought I liked to drive. But I just loved to hear them sing. They're beautiful singers. So that was one of the greatest times of my life, is getting to spend time with my children and getting to spend time with these kids too. And I just am so heartbroken because she was such a good kid. She always used to, I'd tell her hair looked nice all the time, and she'd always say, you know, you have none. So she'd come into church, and she had her hair up. I'd send her a text message saying, beautiful hair. And she'd always say, you have none.
Right over here, right behind you there, Terry.
Hi, I'm Kylie. I grew up with Kiri through middle school and high school. I was on cheer with her, and she was one of my best friends in the world. And everything that everybody said is absolutely true about her. She was the person that kind of held me together when things were really hard, inside and outside of school. I have so many memories with her of her just doing, we're just doing the goofiest things. Also on her YouTube channel is probably the most embarrassing video of me ever. She would put together skits, and every costume you saw in that slideshow, I've worn them all, even the baby ones. She was just probably the most fun, inspiring, creative, coolest person that I've ever known. And when even things like cheer, when I was struggling a little bit with my tumbling past in competition season, and she was next to me in our routine, and we had to do the same thing. And every single time she knew I was really nervous, so she would look at me first and do this like goblin face or make some weird face and like count our, like we had the same count, so she would start counting, and it always just gave me the confidence and everything was fine. And I have a million stories like that of her. She was just such a beautiful person. I love her so much.
Hi, I'm Erin. Kiri and I were pretty much inseparable in high school. We cheered together. We spent pretty much every moment we possibly could together. There was a 2-week period where we would spend the night at each other's house every single night, alternating houses. I'm surprised her parents did not get sick of me at that point. Kiri was such a beautifully creative person. She would take the smallest idea and make it extravagant and perfect with every single small detail. She truly was a beautiful person in and out, and I just will miss her dearly. She was one of my best friends. And she really was a rock, like a solid person in my life for a long time, and I just miss her dearly.
Well, I know there might be more, but so as we don't stay here all day, I know some of you are probably hungry, and we got some food downstairs, I'd like to finish with a word from Grandma Anna, and it's in on the little handout here. You can see on the back there. Kiriana, Kiriana, what can I say? You were too good for this world, so God swept you away. You will have no more worries, no more sorrow or pain. I will always feel honored that we shared the same name. You will always be remembered for your beauty and grace. No one, yes, no one can ever take your place. My namesake was such an honor to me. You will never be forgotten from this evil world. You are free. Love, Grandma Anna. And I want to invite Luke, if he's brave enough, to come up and close us in prayer. And after we're done, don't run off. Stick around. We've got goodies downstairs. You can hang out downstairs if it's still cool. It's a little warm up here, I know, but it should be cooler downstairs. We also have tables outside. Just enjoy yourself. Go out and sit in the amphitheater if you want, but just fellowship together a little more and share with the family. Maybe you didn't weren't bold enough to share in the large group, but share with the family and fill out the little cards, please. Make sure you sign into the guest book, and thank you all for coming. Come on up, Luke.
Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for each and every person in this room today gathered to share in the joy and the memories and the laughter and celebrating who Kiri is and was to each and every one of us. Lord, thank you so much for sending your son Jesus, that through him we could have the hope of eternal life. And we know that's where Kiri is now, looking down on us, watching as we still run the race that's set before us. Kiri's race is run, and she ran it beautifully. I just pray that as we leave this place and as we resume our race, that we would run it in a way that brings honor to her name and her memory, that we can leave this place and see the world through her eyes, appreciating the beauty of your creation and showing a deeper love and empathy for those around us, even the animals. Thank you so much, Lord, for 28 years with Kiri. Thank you so much for the blessing that she was to each and every one of us. It's hard not to be upset that we feel like we lost so much time with her, and to instead just be grateful that you gave 28 years of her life to us to live and share with. Thank you most of all, Lord, for making Kiri. You knew her in a way that each and every one of us didn't. You knew her deeper and more intimately, and you created her to be everything that she was to us. I think my dad said it best, that some people are just too wonderful, too gentle, too beautiful for this world, and so you take them home. And we know that when our race is run, that's where we will see her again. Thank you for that hope, Lord. We pray all this in your son Jesus' name. Amen.
Have a wonderful afternoon.